Welcome to November's Chapel. Today our chapel is going to focus on, as it says, gathering at the table, which I'll get into in a little bit, what that exactly means for the purpose of our chapel today. But before we do, I'm going to have us start by saying our Rectory Chapel Covenant together. So if you could all stand, get the blood flowing in our bodies. Actually, you know what? George, missed you. Sorry, bud. We're going to still stand. George is going to ring our bell. George is going to ring it. Did we decide 8 times, Father Crossman? 8 times. And after the bell is done ringing, I would like you to stay still with your bodies. And as I said last time, I want you to listen so closely to that moment where you feel that bell ringing is just fading away to nothing. See how long in your mind you can hear it lasting. So please keep your body still.
Thank you.
Rectory, Tori, who's going to play something on the clarinet called The Good Life.
Reminder of who we are and what we can do. Your mind must continue to survive. Every meal has potential to become a small family, resurrect links between our ancestors before us and in the future of our people.
Jesus says, "Here I am, I stand at the door right now. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person. And then with me, go eat your food with gladness and drink your wine with joyful heart. For God has already approved what you do. My food," said Jesus, "is to do the will of him who sent me to finish the work."
Thank you.
going to move on to our fourth reading.
You prepare a banquet for me, where all my enemies can see me. You welcome me as an honored guest, and fill my cup to the brim. And you will eat, and you will be satisfied, says the Torah. And you will bless the LRD your for the good and expansive land which he gave you.
The powder itself covers treasures and things, which deftly using your right hand to gracefully sweep the food across the plantain leaf with your tongue out. When the last morsel disappeared, several family members would say that banana e cava. And all the staff would say, may the one providing the food be happy and healthy. Customs and food contributed to the celebration of community and of deliciousness.
Before we share some words and thoughts, we're going to hear from Chloe one song. table. How many of you look forward to the holidays that you celebrate with your family? Hopefully gonna see every hand up. Yeah, cool. Well, I sent out that Google form about what's important to you in holidays, in the mealtime particularly. And I got so many responses, so thank you for those that filled out those responses out. And there was a theme for sure. One was the food, right? And I got all the list of everyone's favorite food. I know who loves stuffing and who loves apple pie and who loves pancakes and all that other stuff. The food was one. The community or the people that you spend it with, right? That was a big one, especially when you live so far away from your home for some of you. Being able to be together with your family or whoever you choose to spend it with at that time is a big deal. So food, family, or community. And the third one was tradition. How many of you right now could just, you don't have to share it, but raise your hand if you can think of something that you do every time at Christmas or Hanukkah or Thanksgiving or whatever you celebrate, right? We all have those little traditions, and they're not big, elaborate traditions. Sometimes they're something so little, something silly. Before I share some of my own thoughts of what I learned from reading all of your responses, I would like to invite Mrs. Haynes up because she has a family tradition that is important to her and her family, and I asked her if she could share it. So you can just stand there, you can stand here, whatever you want to do.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Let's stand over here. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Okay. I wanted to share, I shared with Mrs. Bissett one of my favorite family traditions that we do every Christmas. So while she was asking the questions and I was thinking about the food and thinking about the holidays and thinking about family, what immediately popped into my head is what my family does every Christmas morning. So Christmas morning, if you celebrate Christmas, you might think of it the way I did as a kid, with waking up and immediately doing what? Opening presents, right? And whoever gets up the earliest wakes everybody else up, whether they like it or not. Mom and dad are rubbing their eyes. And then you rip open the presents, and that's so fun, right? So, when I met my husband a couple decades ago, I was 18. A couple years into our relationship, I started spending Christmas morning with the Haynes family instead of mine. So that's what I expected. We wake up early, we'll rip open presents, and then I guess we'll watch football. So, which we still do, but it happened a little differently. So we wake up, everybody woke up at their own pace. There was no little kids to wake us up. So we woke up at our own pace, the smell of coffee, you know, the Christmas music lightly playing in the background. I walk out, people are just sitting. Nobody's really doing anything. So I sat down, my soon-to-be husband, my then 20-year-old boyfriend, kind of comes sauntering or clomping really the way he walks. Down the hallway and sits next to me. And then finally, everybody gathers and we open stockings. And I said, okay, now it's time for presents, right? And then dad gets up, my husband's dad, and he goes into the kitchen and he starts making breakfast. And I was like, what's happening? So I look at my husband, or soon to be husband, with this quizzical look on my face, like, but what about the kids? And he says, we take it slow. Okay, so, and slowly did. So, dad makes breakfast, he comes in a long while later with this little mini pancake and a little pat of butter on it, and he comes over to me and he said, will you eat the test pancake? And everybody looks and turns and smiles at me, and I was like, why is everybody staring at me? And so, I ate it, and I kind of gave an awkward like, oh, that's a great pancake. I know now that everybody was looking and everybody was smiling because the test pancake is special. And so for me, they were telling me, I'm a part of the family. So, he finishes the pancakes after lots of clomping and noise in the kitchen and a huge mess. He's not a clean cook. We eat breakfast, it's the best pancakes I've ever had, best syrup I've ever had. I never had like Connecticut syrup before, that's some good syrup. Never gone back to the store stuff anymore. And then, we do presents, but it just didn't really seem like that important anymore. The presents were kind of an afterthought. It was that meal of pancakes. So every year since, we've had pancakes, and it's my favorite part. My husband's sister, she lives in North Carolina. She would come back every once in a while. She would get the test pancake when she came back, and it was special. Then she would bring her husband, he got the test pancake. My nieces would get the test pancake. And I really understood, you know, that tradition of the test pancakes and the pancakes. But the story's not just about pancakes. I love pancakes, don't get me wrong, but the story's not about pancakes. About 5 years ago, my father away, and I thought, it was hard, it was challenging, he was, you know, important to us. And I thought, what about the pancakes? Not what about the pancakes, but what about the pancakes? And my husband decided, I'm going to make the pancakes. No, he's never made pancakes, so I was a little worried about it, but with the help of Logan, they made the pancakes and the bacon. Logan was master bacon maker. Okay, very patient with it. I go too fast. He's great. So we continue the tradition of pancakes. And it's not about the pancakes. It's about the communing with your family. You know, so when we have pancakes now, it's just the four of us. It's Logan, myself, my husband, and my mother-in-law. But when we're sitting at that table, no matter how small our family is at that table, we're communing with Tracy and Vinny and my nieces, that's my sister-in-law and my brother-in-law down in North Carolina. They're with us. They're eating pancakes too. They still make pancakes. Tracy makes pancakes every Christmas morning. We're communing with the blueberries. The blueberries are picked from my mother-in-law's grandmother's blueberry bush. We freeze them for the winter. So when we're eating those blueberry pancakes, we're communing with those who aren't with us anymore. We're communing with Great Grim Snow. And of course, we commune with my father. The man who started it all. So the gifts are cool, but the pancakes are great. And the family is what it's all about. So I encourage you to take it slow.
So now I need 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 volunteers. All right, so we'll go Ethan, Alan, Huxley, Amelia, Gavin, and yes. Did I just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5? Perfect. Take a seat around the table, my friends. So here we have our little, yeah, there we go. We know there's so many stories around Baker's Dozen, and I can personally tell you that when my children who went to Rectory come back to Rectory to visit, they'll always comment on, remember Mom, you used to take us down to Baker's Dozen on the break, or all of those fun memories. Before the prison concert, my kids would come to get my coffee. So Baker's Dozen is an important thing, and as a matter of fact, over the summer we had two alumni who were in their 20s came to visit Rectory, surprised Rectory with a visit, they're in college now, and they brought a dozen Baker's Dozen donuts with them. And I said, why don't you bring these? And they're like, you know, we're here. We just had to get Baker's Dozen. And so they handed them out to the kids in summer school, which was very fun. So here's our meal today, okay? But before I'm gonna let you eat it, we're gonna just do something, okay? So let's put all these. No tradition to volunteer. All right, there we go. So, but as Mrs. Haynes so nicely described, it is so much more than the food. We love the food. Of course we love the food. But we're fed in a different way too, right? We're fed spiritually. We're fed emotionally. And whether you understand that metaphor or not, I hope you get it after today's chapter. So I would like each of you to pick up your plate and turn it over. There's something written on the back of everybody's plate. Okay, so Ethan, can you raise your plate up high? Can anyone read what this says?
Laughing.
Is there laughing usually at these meals at some point?
Yeah.
Yeah, I hope so. All right, Alan, what does yours say?
Remembering those who have died.
Oh, remembering those who have died. Sometimes it's a time where we come together and we say, remember great grandma, or remember grandpa, or remember this friend. And it is a comforting time to be together and share that memory. All right, Huxley, what does Huxley say?
Supporting each other,
supporting one another. Maybe we come together after a stressful semester at school. and you're like, oh, it's getting really hard, or I'm worried about secondary schools, or just I'm tired, and we support each other around that table. Amelia, what does her say?
Telling stories.
That can mean a lot of things, right? That could be a funny story that happened to you, or it could be an important story you want to make sure everyone in your family knows about.
Sharing memories.
That's my favorite thing to do at meals, is to share, hey, remember that, remember this, those moments that keep your family story alive or your community story alive. And that's done in a lot of religions as well. So, for example, in the Jewish Seder, Seder is the name for the meal that happens at the Shabbat dinner. And there are very specific prayers said around each step of the meal. And that is telling the story of the Jewish people. That's a huge part of keeping the Jewish traditions alive and telling their story as a people. In Catholic and most Christian churches, many Christian churches, a story is told every Sunday up at an altar where they break bread together. They're telling the story for some people. Raise your hand if you're Catholic, or if you go to a church, or if you've gone to a church where you get communion. Raise your hand. Okay, so many of you know this. That is telling that story every week of how Jesus shared a meal with his friends before he died. So that's a story that's told every Sunday in some churches. So most religions in the world, most major world religions, have mealtime, a gathering around the table, as a big part of their faith. That's not a coincidence. We have that as a common need amongst us as human beings, wherever we live on this planet. There's one more here that we've ended up cheers for. Oh, very important one.
We give thanks.
And of course, we're entering that season where we typically say, oh, don't forget to be thankful. And I thought of doing an entire chapel about gratitude, but you know what? We should be doing this every day, right? But we remember it around November. We call it the season of Thanksgiving. But really, it should be done all the time, and it is typically done at mealtime, isn't it? So raise your hand if at some point in your life someone has said a grace or a thank you prayer at the start of a meal. Okay, so some of us. Yeah, a lot of us. And at Rectory School, earlier on, that was a part, you wouldn't be allowed to start eating until the headmaster or whoever was running the dining hall would say grace. Just to remind us that we should be thankful for that food. So having been waiting such a long time to grab their donut holes, look at the discipline. All right. I'm going to let you take two for each. Okay? Put one on your napkin. And just don't make crumbs in the pew, okay? Okay. Can we hear it for our volunteers? Thank you. right. Instead of our closing blessing, we're going to end with this prayer that you just got handed out. And could I just have one copy? Can I take one? Thank you. All right. I will read what the left side that says one, and you will read the part that says all. Are you ready? This is a prayer for peace. God, so many people are in pain. When people around us don't agree and think differently, when we see people getting hurt, when we see people treated poorly because of their skin color or language or religious belief, when we see war and conflict, when we see pain, when we feel confused and afraid, in our lives, our neighborhoods, and the world,
teach us to pray.
Thank you, and have a wonderful rest.